today's program over to Jody Norman for the next installment of our floor memory series of programs. Jody.
Good morning, everyone. I'll be here today. I thought I'd start off by introducing myself a little bit. I have an undergraduate degree in photography, and I worked for a number of years in the field. I also worked for the State Archives for almost 30 years. I started in 1984 as the Archives photographer, and I worked 17 years in the Florida Photographic Collection, which is the Archives photo collection. Today, I oversee the Archives photo collection, direct the Florida Memory Web Program, and supervise the State Archives Reference Desk. I was when my colleagues approached me about doing this webinar, because in those 30 years I've been with the archives, I've been contacted many times by people who want to know more about their photographs or more about their photographic collections. Archive curators, historians, private citizens. So today my plan is to talk to you about the most common and easily identifiable photographic processes. My goal is to provide you with information that will assist in identifying and dating images. Actually, my primary goal is to finish speaking before you finish listening. So I plan to move at a comfortable pace, but not linger too long on one subject. As Stephanie said, we'll stop intermittently through the slideshow for questions. I did a couple of caveats about the presentation before we begin. The range that I've applied to each process applies to the most popular period of use. The dates are not absolute begin and end dates in all cases. And also, due to time limitations, the memory limitations, I'm going into any great detail regarding the physical chemistry involved in the production of each process. So, for example, let's say when we talk about cyanotypes, I'm going to talk about how many parts of potassium ferricyanide and ferric ammonium were used in producing cyanotypes, but I will talk about the physical attributes achieved from that combination. Now, if that's the kind of thing you're interested in, if you want to know more about the physical composition, if you want to know more about the makeup of a particular photographic process, drop me an email at the end of the webinar. I'm happy to respond. So, start with the daguerreotype. Daguerreotype is the earliest practical process of photography. It was first produced in 1839. They're exposing the image on a sensitized silver plated sheet of copper, and the surface is highly reflective. The daguerreotype is almost always reversed. There's no negative use in the process. The photographer could use a mirror or a prism to correct the image, but they rarely did because of long exposure times. That highly reflective surface is a great way to tell the difference between a cased daguerreotype, between that and an amber type and a ten type. Most of the types were portraits. There were two types of photographers, two types of daguerreotypists, but frankly, there were two types of photographers because they carried on the profession many years after the daguerreotype wasn't in use anymore. There was the urban studio daguerreotypist or the urban studio photographer, and the itinerant, the traveler. Daguerreotypist or itinerant traveling photographer. We've got a couple of images up here for you to look at that came from the photographic collection. The daguerreotypist or the itinerant photographer frequently traveled in wagons. They carried samples of their work and their equipment. Some of them even traveled on steamboats. They floated their studios up and down rivers. You can see the two photos on the far right. The artist, who you charged a little bit more than the traveling photographer, had a studio, and those studios were very often located at the top of a building with a glass roof or a partial glass roof that let in as much light as possible. Now, they wanted to let in as much light as possible because you have that long exposure time. So the more light, the more you could shorten the exposure time. If you take a look at the image in the bottom left, that's an image from Alvin Harper's studio in Tallahassee. The subject seated in a chair. The chair actually was called the posing chair. It was on a raised platform. You can see the raised platform. And that platform would actually, it could be rotated left to right to face the light. because of the long exposure time, the sit head was held still by a clamp or a board at the back of the chair. An idea of how long daguerreotype exposures could be. When they were first introduced in 1839, the exposure time ranged from 15 to 30 minutes. In 1841, the time ranged from 20 to 90 seconds. In 1842, it had shortened to 10 to 60 seconds. So I can all understand that's a long time to sit still, much less hold a smile, and might explain why many of the early portraits people look for particularly unhappy. They actually were just trying to sit still long enough for the exposure to be made. As I said, most daguerreotypes were portraits. So daguerreotypes of famous people, funerals, groups of people, soldiers, those are considered more rare. Hand is somewhat unusual, certainly not rare. There's two kinds of tinting. There's accent tinting and area tinting. So when you see an image with tinted cheeks or buttons or maybe just the sash or the belt on the image is tinted, accent tinting, and then area tinting is when the majority of the image has been colored. We're looking at on this slide two of the State Archives' earliest daguerreotypes, and both of these are considered rare images. The top right image is a bird's eye view of Key West made in 1849, and it's the earliest known landscape image of Florida that we know of. The bottom image is of a slave named Mama Molly. She was brought to Jefferson County by the Partridge family in the 1830s. Big expense, unusual to see a daguerreotype of a slave, especially one that's been hand tinted. In this case, it's been area tinted. Almost the entire image has been tinted. We assumed when the image was donated to the State Archives that that Mama Molly was special to the family. And years later, when the Partridge family donated their family diaries, there were several passages that confirmed that it actually was special to the family. Also about coloring of images, first in general, because you see a lot of that. Water oils, crayons, pastels, all kinds of paints and dyes were applied to the image surface, and they could be applied using brushes, photographer's fingers, cotton swabs, etc. Specifically with the daguerreotype, the surface of the plate was coated with a thin film of gum arabic left to dry. The photographer, or sometimes a colorist, would then breathe on the treated plate to make it sticky again, and with a fine paintbrush, applied dry powdered pigment. I go into all the types of ways images were hand tinted over the years because many of it was just homegrown ingredients. But there is a lot more detail than what I've supplied right here, just so that there were all kinds of colors, pastels, Dante pencils, a large number of different types of media were applied to the image surface, and that varied from process to process. It's always mounted in cases. Those cases included a cover glass, a mat, and a preserver. The plate, mat, and glass were sealed with tape to reduce the oxidization and the tarnishing of the plate. And of course, glass protected the delicate surface. Daguerreotypes could never be disassembled by anyone but a trained conservator, but come across or happen to get so curious you can't stand it and you disassemble a daguerreotype, remember that surface is way sensitive. So if you touch it with your thumb or your finger, you've made that fingerprint immortal. With as the image goes, it will not come off. Another way to tell if you're looking at a daguerreotype is that sometimes there will be a hallmark or a manufacturer's logo, like you can see in the bottom right-hand side of the slide, on the plate. And the hallmark is really the plate manufacturer's or photo supply house's mark. And they consist of symbols, initials, and numbers. And I'm not sure what all the symbols and initials mean, but the number indicates the ratio of silver to copper. It's a date, a daguerreotype, unless you know a lot about photo supply. supply houses or manufacturers of photographic supplies. But if you see that hallmark, you can pretty much guarantee you're looking at a daguerreotype. So as you said, daguerreotypes were produced in a variety of sizes. The 6 plates, 2 3/4 by 3 1/4 is the most common. Larger size, the double hole plate, that's on the wall of a fan home, for example, like we might hang up an 8x10 print today. And sometimes the smallest daguerreotypes, they would be put in lockets or brooches. Daguerreotype price, the average cost was approximately $5. That was about a week's wage, so that made them not that affordable for a lot of families. Daguerreotype was a variation of the wet collodion process, and it was sometimes called the glass daguerreotype. They flourished as the cheap competitor of the daguerreotype. The price of the amber type ranged from 25 cents to $2.50. The amber type is slightly underexposing a glass wet plate in a camera. The plate was a negative image, so it had to be backed. And it was backed by a variety of things, velvet, paper, metal. Sometimes the back of the glass was even varnished. The amber type is often really contrasty, and that's one of its identifying features. Daguerreotype, amber types were almost always enclosed in a case because of the fragileness of the particular process. Now about the union cases, that's what these cases were called, the cases that were enclosed the processes. The term union refers to the material construction of the cases. The term is derived from the union of the cases components. And that would be shellac, sawdust, a various number of chemicals, dyes that were used for coloring the cases. Some design on the case can help date the image. That's providing that the image is in its original case. There's a really great book called The American Miniature Case Art by Flynn and Marion Reinhardt. It's no longer in print, but you can get it on Amazon. I use it all the time. And late 1850s cases were usually leather, or they were wood covered with leather, lined with felt and sometimes silk. And it was about 1856 that a composite made from sawdust and varnish, which was called thermoplastic, was used to create the cases. The cases are collector's items over the years. I've heard stories of antique dealers who have gotten and wonderful amber types and daguerreotypes in and actually taken the image out, thrown it away, and then sold the cases themselves as cigarette holders. I wouldn't recommend that. Another way to date the images is to look at the brass mats that are in the cases. Early brass mats had simple designs and became more and more ornate, pretty significantly ornate in the 1850s. The observer, which is a brass mat frame that wraps around the glass mat and the image, that was used the first time in 1847. So the early daguerreotypes didn't have that preserver. Anything after 1847 did have it. Next is tintype. Type was also called the ferrotype or melanotype. It ranged in popularity from circa 1858 to 1910. The tintype is a variation of the collodion wet process. In this case, the emulsion was painted directly onto a japanned or varnished iron plate. There's tin in the tintype, by the way. Sturdy in earlier processes, tintypes could be mailed. It made it really, really popular during the Civil War. So you have low cost, durability, and ace in traveling photographers, so the popularity went off the charts when tintypes were introduced. The price, like amber types, range from 25 cents to $2.50. I will hear that amber types tended to be on the high end of that scale, and tintypes tended to be on the low end of that scale, so tintypes were a little bit cheaper than amber types. there was an introduction of a something called a chocolate tintype or a brown tintype, and that introduction came in 1870 and can be identified by the brown hue of the image. So if you have a brown or a chocolate tintype, you know pretty much that the date is 1870 and beyond. Closed in paper sleeves or in the union cases, and sometimes in family albums. When they're in a union case, tintypes are often confused with amber types. They look very similar inside that case. But the way you can tell the difference is that a tintype will have a duller, a less contrasty surface, and there's almost always cracks and creases in the varnished emulsion on the surface of the print. Another way you can identify tintype is by using a magnet. That's out of the case in order to do that, of course. Light type and amber type, tintypes are usually reversed. They come in a variety of sizes, and the most common size is 2.5 by 3.5. So we covered three processes. If anyone has questions at this point, I'm happy to give them a go.
So just a reminder that you can put your question into the Q&A panel, you can add it to the chat, or if you wanted to just speak, if you click on the hand button, then we'll unmute your telephone and you can ask your question out loud. I did have a question, Jody. When at some point you talked about not taking the image out of their cases,
right?
Is that the, would that be true for all three types of photos that you just talked about?
Absolutely. If a tintype is also enclosed in a union case, you leave it. There's a certain intrinsic value. There's also a certain amount of safety in leaving them in that case. They're more protected. I should have mentioned that the glass and the mat and the backing of those images is together to prevent any sort of air getting in,
okay,
and keeps the image from degrading or deteriorating more. So they're more protected. So I always would recommend leaving them in the case.
Okay.
Not totally opposed. If you have someone trained to disassemble them to see if there isn't more information. I can't tell you how many times I've taken apart a daguerreotype or an amber type, and in the back of that case, there's a hand note piece of paper that tells you more about the subject and what's going on in the image.
Oh, that's neat.
Yeah.
Any questions? Okay. Yet, so I'm just going to remind folks, as we go along, as you have questions, and I imagine questions will come to people, you can put them into chat, you can put them into the Q&A, or raise your hand, and we'll take some questions in a little bit.
Okay, great. Next, we're going to talk about glass negatives. Glass negatives represented a really huge shift in photography, because unlike the daguerreotype, the amber type, and the tintype, they were all unique images, right? One of a kind. Photographers could produce several copies of the same image using one negative. That was incredible, and it took off like crazy. There are types of glass negatives. They're easy to tell one from the other. We'll start with the collodion wet plate negative. The collodion came into use in 1851. It surged in popularity until the 1880s. The wet plate can be identified by an unevenly coated emulsion, and that's because the photographer had to use the plate wet. So he or she had to paint that emulsion on right before they stuck it in the camera. So when painted it, it was uneven typically. The glass used is thick, it's rough edges. And the thing I like most when I find this, at least, is that frequently you'll see the photographer's thumbprint on the edge of that glass, because after all, he or she had to hold that glass in order to paint the emulsion on it. So if you thumbprint in the corner of either of these glass negatives, you can pretty much count on that wet plate glass negative. In fact, you can count on it. The second glass negative process was called a gelatin dry plate. That was introduced in 1871, and by 1873, they were commercially available. And you can see in the slide, they were produced by a number of manufacturers. Unlike it was usable when dry, which made it possible for manufacturers to produce them. It had less exposure to light, the glass was thinner, and the emulsion was evenly coated onto the plate. The salt print. Salt print's a little bit trickier to identify without a light scope, but I'll give you some basic information that may help you with that. Salt process was used for making positive prints from negatives. In the beginning, they used a calotype or a paper negative, and they moved to glass negatives. They either reddish brown, purple, or yellow brown, and has a matte surface, a very textured surface. If you took a light scope and looked at a salt, it would look a lot like a paper used at the same time, that those prints were being made. They always show some evidence of image fading, and the highlights are always white. The most common paper print until the albumen print was introduced was the salt paper print. Next up, portraits. I always say every family's got a crayon portrait somewhere. Somebody does. And this is a little tricky process because people frequently misidentify crayon portraits for drawings or paintings. And I'll try and explain why that is. They were paper prints that were made in an enlarging photograph and enlarged to near life size. In fact, they were the first life-size photographic image that was available for portraiture. They were made with what was called a developing out process, and they were one of the first developing out processes, meaning to use chemicals to make the image appear. That developing out process was a very weak one, and so in order to make the image stand out more, they were heavily overlaid with charcoals or pastels. Later, I think, the pastels and charcoals were used to make the photograph look more like a drawing and less like a photograph. Two images before we move to the next slide. I think it's important to point out that the artist or the photographer who was doing the coloring could make a really beautiful image, or depending on their skill, could come up with a really malformed, kind of scary-looking image. And I find the image of Andrew Jackson in the top right to be not quite proportional. I think they did a good job. But again, artists had a lot to do with how the final product came out. Beta produce by enlarging a photograph onto drawing paper. Photo, of course, as we mentioned, was a faint image, and the artist drew over the picture with charcoal or pastels, trying to duplicate the photograph while making it look hand-drawn. Frame, large gilded or ornately decorated frames. That's the way they usually come into the archives. And they have a concave or convex shape to them. Without doubt, the most easy to identify photographic process known to man is the cyanotype. It can be identified by its bright blue uniform color. Cyanotypes have a matte surface, and the medium date from the 1880s to the 1920s. Just a note, the blue tone of a cyanotype was not desirable for most professional photographers. There was very little commercial work done with cyanotypes. And again, I didn't want to go into this too much, but cyanotypes are contact prints. They were printed with something called a printing frame, where the negative was placed against a very sensitive sheet of paper. I mentioned two of those chemicals in the beginning of the presentation. And in light, something like sunlight, for just a few minutes, and then washed and dried in a stable format. a stable process. It lacked complexity, and as a result, it appealed and was used by many amateurs. The ease of the process caused a wave of popularity at the turn of the century. The images were always produced on thin paper, and that paper curled and tore and had all kinds of issues if they were not mounted in, on a board of heavy cardstock or mounted in albums. Just on the side, this particular process is still popular today with fine art photographers. It's kind of beautiful and very artsy. And every time I look up at the top right edge, I think a quote by American author Eudora Welty, who said, "A good snapshot keeps the moment from running away." And I think they've done that very well by running away. It's a beautiful image. Next, albumen. Now, the albumen was introduced in 1850. It was the most common kind of print in the 19th century. And 80% of all surviving known 19th century images are albumens. So an albumen, like some of the others that we've talked about, is generally glossy, and that's because they used an egg white consistency in the process of the print. And like cyanotype, salt prints were printed on very thin paper, so they were almost always mounted on a heavy cardstock. Came in arranged in color from purple to chocolate brown, and the yellow, and the highlights are yellow. Again, like the other processes, came in a number of sizes. That list here. The of the Z or the CV was the most common popular size until the middle or late 1860s and into the 1870s when the larger cabinet card replaced the CDV as the most common form of portraiture. CDVs used albumen prints and were mounted on 2.5 by 4 inch cards. It became a crazy fad. They were commonly exchanged on birthdays and holidays, kind of what we do our business cards today, but I think to even to more of an extreme than that. The Carte de Visite album was a common fixture in parlors. I thought a little bit how to narrow the date. I gave you a general date range for albumens, but we could narrow that date more when you talk specifically about CDVs. The first, if you look at the card thickness of a CDV, early cards were very thin, they became thicker in 1870, and then became even more thick in 1880. Another feature, the card corners, square corners dominated the cards until 1870, and then rounded corners took over. The images on the card, if you look at the images we have here, you see that varies. Images that were less than 3/4 inch, dated between 1860 and 1864. It's about 1 inch in size, can be dated from 1862 to 1867. Images between 1.5 inches and 1 3/4 inches can be dated between 1865 and 1872. Images that fill the complete card can be dated between 1874 and 1910. There's also card borders. No border, if there's no border at all on the image, you can date the image between 1860 and 1862. If there are two thin lines, you can date the image between 1862 and 1863. One line, one thin line, and one thicker line, like, for instance, the bottom two right images, you can date those images between 1864 and 1869. And if there's one card with a very thick border, say the little child in the middle, you can pretty much count on those dates being between 1874 and 1880. A fine dating CDVs is the studio props and backgrounds used when taking the images. First, let's, you know, just put out there, all of these images were made in studios, okay? they still had longer exposure times as well. But until the late 1860s, the background was either void or consisted only of a chair or a small table or some object that the subject could use that helped him or her stand still. So if you look at the top left, the bottom right where the child is sitting leaning on the table, that would be a good example of minimal props. And some of just the portraits where there's no props, there's no background at all. Around 70, decorative backdrops and more props were used. So take a look at the middle shot and shot on the bottom left. Definitely they brought in many more props, the more decorative. So you can pretty much count on those images being made 1870 or later. I'm going on about CDVs a little bit because people have large collections of them, and I think they are of interest to many of us out there. Another way to get a CDV is the tax revenue stamp that was used by the U.S. government to raise funds to fight the Civil War. In the beginning of the Civil War, the Union government placed the Revenue Act of 1862 and taxed all kinds of luxury goods. Things like bank cards, telegrams, kinds of stuff. But in 1864, as the war continued and the funding diminished, Congress passed an act that also taxed photographs. Not paper photographs, but amber types and daguerreotypes. So photographers were required to collect the tax, apply the stamp showing the tax had been paid, and then cancel the stamp by initialing and dating it. So if you look at the examples that we have on the slide here, you can see the photographer's mark or initials on every single stamp on that slide except in the middle. The two-cent stamp is either blue or orange, and the three-cent stamp is green. The most common stamps are 2- and 3-cent stamps because most CVs, and tin types, by the way, cost between 25 cents and 50 cents. They're kind of funky denominations that you might know about as well, or you might have in your collections. And one included 50 cents to a $1 tax stamp, which was red. And then in 1865, Congress reduced the tax on images costing under 10 cents to a 1-cent tax stamp, and produced a very rare red stamp as well. Finally, on all the album imprints, all the mounted album imprints, it's not uncommon at all to have a photographer's stamp. And that stamp can tell you actually quite a bit of information. It may just have the photographer's name and the location of his or her studio, but there's plenty of publication and compiled research where you should be able to go and get more information when that photographer practiced, et cetera. So I'm stopping, maybe I'm stopping too frequently, but if anyone has questions at this point, I'm ready and willing to answer.
Again, a reminder that you can raise your hand, as Karen has done, and we'll unmute your telephone, or you can put your question into the Q&A panel or into the chat. So it looks like Karen has a question. Karen, if you do star six will unmute your telephone, so if you want to go ahead and unmute your telephone and ask your question, that'd be great. Karen, are you do star six, and then just go ahead and ask your question.
Am I there? I have some, which I think are daguerreotypes. They have been kept in a very dark drawer for however long I've had them. They were my grandmother's. How can they be expected to last if they're protected, kept away from light?
Well, you should consider. One is the enclosure that the daguerreotype is in. Okay, you want an acid-free enclosure. I don't know how you're storing them now.
Union cases.
On that union case, should have a acid-free small box that fits that union case pretty snugly, or you can find just paper sleeves that it should slide into comfortably and be able to be pulled out in and out without damaging the case.
Okay.
That's the first step. The second step is I don't know where the drawer is, but like most photographic processes, you want it as cool and dry as possible. So
in the house, and we have the air conditioning, of course.
Okay, that's good. Has been disassembled?
I haven't done it, so I don't know whether it was ever done before I came into possession of them. I don't think so.
Okay. Do you see any deterioration on the plate itself?
Well, I'm not where it is right now. It's up in Middleburg at home, and I'm a student at the University of South Florida, St. Petersburg, so I'm in Pinellas Park. And I have taken them out and looked at them for a long time, but they're still visible. You can tell, that there are people.
Well, let's explore what you just said a little bit more. Does that mean you know who the people are?
I think they're... Well, this is awfully complicated. I have a rather complicated genealogy.
Right.
I think they're my great-aunt's great-grandparents.
Okay. So these images have a lot of personal value to you.
Yeah.
Yeah, I would take that union case, put it in a proper enclosure, and that could be an acid-free box or a sleeve, and then take that again and put it in an acid-free box. I prefer to leave the types lay on their back. I know this, they're
right.
very good condition. They can lay up on their sides, but that wouldn't be my preference or recommendation. Cool and dry as possible, as well handling as possible. And maybe, I don't know, do you ever get up to Tallahassee?
Occasionally, yeah. I do research at the State Archive.
Oh, smart woman. If there's possibility one day that you can get your hands on those images and bring them up, I'll be happy to disassemble and reassemble the images. I can also take you up and show you some of the types of enclosures that we have and that we use. And who knows, we might find some great information behind those plates.
Thank you.
You bet.
Well, just a follow-up to that question. Where would you get boxes and sleeves?
That's a good one. I added a few things to the end of the PowerPoint. One is light impressions. The other was, but it's one that I use quite a bit. Do you have some slide? I sent them. Of my tongue, but we use them all the time. These two all the time.
We can find it and set it up.
Yes.
There we go.
There's all kinds of supplies, and not only just supplies. There's the Northeast Document Center, which is lead station in photographic preservation and care. They have a list of suppliers that they recommend.
Okay. The Preservation Center?
Yes.
Perfect.
The nice thing about these places now, they have really great websites. It's easy to order. The prices have come down tremendously, and there's really no reason we shouldn't be using the best and safest storage environments.
Questions before we go?
Okay, well, Karen,
Karen's got another question. Go ahead, Karen, it's star 6 to unmute your phone.
Is there any way to report a copy of your
say that again.
On my cell phone. Is there any safe way to copy or reproduce a daguerreotype, say?
Yes. Yes. The first I recommend is just reproducing it through the glass. You know, opening the case and scanning it that way, or in a photograph. That's,
okay, so
that's
so
the
it would be right to scan it.
Yes. Things we deal with floor memory is you scan. You want to make a great master digital scan. What you don't want to do is go back repeatedly and grab that image and scan it repeatedly.
Right.
Twice to get my drift. You don't want to scan it over and over again. So the idea is to get the best possible scan, and then you can go back to that scan and work with it. Now, there are certain issues that could happen by trying to go through the glass. You know, if there's tarnish, if there's glare, if there's bad, if the glass itself has been damaged. I find that frequently. The glass is in terrible shape. I take the glass off, and the daguerreotype underneath is beautiful, flawless almost.
Okay.
You bet.
Any questions? And we have another folks. Sarah has pushed out another link to a source for supplies, the conservation and historic artifacts, another source of supplies and information. And Tom, you've got number 6 to unmute your phone. So Tom, if you want to go ahead and unmute your phone.
I've done that. I just want to make an observation because probably I may be the only one of everyone who has actually had a daguerreotype taken. And believe me, it is definitely difficult to sit very still for the minute or more it takes to make the exposure. But it did turn out all right. I was in a place where they took vintage photographs of that type, but believe me, it is one of the. It sounds easy, but it's very hard to do.
How long did you have to sit, Tom?
I remember it to be about somewhere between 2 and 3 minutes.
Yeah, that's a long time. I mean, not only can't smile, you can't really blink.
No, you really can't, and that's. I imagine that was really the hardest thing for my sister and I, but we still have the photographs, and they're a lot of fun to look at, but I wouldn't recommend it for everyone. Actually, I saw once a temporary picture taken in the 1850s where this mother has her baby on her lap, and he literally has him in the death grip, and somehow they got the photo.
Did they thing in the back of the chair to hold your head?
No, they did have a clamp, but we decided to try without, and actually we were just able to hold still enough. And it is difficult because if you see contemporary photographs, you see what looks like shadow people, and that's because they moved too fast for the camera.
Sure. So happy with the results?
Yeah, actually, I am, and you know, a lot of people think it's a great. At first glance, some people have thought it was an old photograph that was a contemporary, but it really wasn't.
That's a very cool thing. I'd like to check that out one day, I think.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a lot of fun when it's over.
I hear you.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Or comments? We're ready to continue.
Nope. Well, one of my most favorites is the stereo view. This is the 19th century answer to 3D. The images were taken with a special stereoscopic camera. Had two lenses, and the result was a double photograph or printed image paired in such a way that when viewed with the stereoscope, it appeared as a 3D or a solid image. I can't say too much about how to identify them. I mean, it's pretty clear. It's obvious you have two photographs paired together on one board. The earlier views were daguerreotypes. Could you ask Melissa? There's one thing I forgot to mention, just so people understand this better. Stereoscopes or stereo viewers work the same way your vision works. So we all know that our eyes are positioned 2 inches apart. We see everything from two slightly different angles, and our brain processes those two views into a single picture that has spatial depth and dimension. And that's how they work. You look into them and you see one image, but it does have depth. The earliest were daguerreotypes, and the rarest were tintypes. They used the card mounts, the color, the thickness, the shape of the photo, the printing used for the label. All of these things could provide a great deal of information about a stereo view. There's another great book. I keep bringing up these great books that are out of date, but you can still find them. And the name of the book was The World of Stereographs, and the author was W.C. Darrow. I've used the book. That book is tattered. You can hardly turn a page in it anymore, but it's an excellent book, and I learned a lot from it. For those of you with large stereo view collections, I highly recommend you get them. Get the book. Slides. Lantern slides are pictures consisted of a positive photograph or a drawing on a transparent base. They have to be viewed with a projector. That projector early on was called the magic lantern. The photographer used two methods, either a contact method in a camera. A contact method or a camera method to produce the image on the glass plate. After the plate was dried, the image could be hand-colored. Used special tints. The slide was finished with a mat, and the glass cover was taped to seal the enclosure. We have a slide showing examples of lantern slides, and I think everybody will agree two things that kind of contradictions in terms. One is the image is always very surreal looking. And two, it actually is very sharp. You get really good detail in parts of the image. A lantern slide allowed photographers to view in an entirely new format. So this was a process that revolutionized photography, because instead of one or two people crowded around the table looking at a single image, this type of slideshow could be enjoyed by small groups, family groups, and by substantial audiences. It was used frequently to teach classes in colleges. It became very, very popular home entertainment, and people come to the archives all the time with their old stereo viewer and their old stereo views, and they want to donate them. They were commercially produced, so there's tons of them around. They're not rare by any stretch. They really do find some unusual and different and fun ones. There was popularity about 1900, but they were continued to be widely used till the 1930s, and that, of course, is when the old traditional 35mm slide came into play. These are two really fun examples of lantern slides. The first one on the top right was a series of promotional slides for the cigar industry. And if you look closely at the slide, you'll see that it was a very creative product. The dress was made of cigars. The airplane was made of cigars. Her boots were made of cigars. And a little beanie hat with the twister on top was also made of cigars. The most favorite lantern slides. no matter what you're looking at or which slide you bring up, like this camping trip in Hillsborough County, you send, it's a ghost-like, surreal image. They're really beautiful. They're almost paint-like. And there was them produced for many years and used a lot. Again, with projectors. They were designed to be used with projectors. Along here, we're up to nitrate cellulose film. Produced in 1888-1899. There's another process that revolutionized photography. Unlike the predecessor of the glass negative, nitrate film was extremely flexible and came in sheets and rolls. So imagine a photographer going out with his 8x10 camera to shoot a landscape instead of worrying about the 10 or 15 glass plate negatives he could carry. Now he had hundreds of these flexible sheet films he could use, and using the same camera, it's required different holders. So unlike its predecessor, the glass negative, the nitrate film was extremely flexible, and it came in sheet rolls. And again, the nitrate had no markings along the edge of the film, but later on, you can identify nitrate film. That was between 1913 and 1939 by the nitrate. Word nitrite embossed along the edge of the negative. Okay, to the nitty-gritty, nitrate film is very hazardous, especially in a deteriorating state. It's highly flammable film. It can ignite, spontaneously ignite at 105 degrees. Burnt nitrate produces carbon monoxide fumes, which are noxious. Flames can extinguish with water, the fire with water, because the oxygen released in the burning nitrate feeds the fire. So, the idea how serious this problem was, Alan Morris, who was then curator of the Florida Photographic Collection and Speaker of the House of Representatives, who did much research at the Library of Congress, in the basement, which was where all the nitrate film was stored, about a sign that hung there many, many years, and that sign said it was over the stairs, which was the exit out of the basement. Then said, in case of fire, run like hell. Deteriorating nitrate should be copied in the film properly disposed of. The condition of nitrate film, as with any photographic medium, should always be a factor in considering that acquisition of such a collection. So if you all are out there and someone offers a nitrate collection, there's many things to think about before you take it besides the content. Even in good condition requires special storage, and in a degraded state it can become an exceedingly costly process. Ideal nitrate film should be not stored in the same location as other media. The nitrate oxide film fumes given off by deteriorating nitrate can cause damage to other negatives and a possible fire hazard. In condition, it should be stored individually sleeved. Never place nitrate film sleeve against sleeve after sleeve. Always individually sleeve. It makes a big difference. The recommended environment is under 20 degrees, freezing, okay, under 20 degrees, and at 20 to 50% relative humidity. Now, when I talk about the recommended environment, keep in mind the state archives can't meet those recommendations. We'd have a special storage unit to put nitrate film in. So you go with the coldest conditions, the coldest temperature, and the lowest relative humidity for all of our film collections.
A couple questions. Got one?
I'm wondering, what are the, you said 20 degrees, so they don't freeze? Or is it a special kind of like dry, cold, or?
It actually is frozen storage, yes. And so what happens is, if you go and you want to take a look at this film, another chamber, this walk-in special storage chamber, and then a second chamber where the film is brought out and it's brought up to room temperature, and that takes an hour to 2 hours before they'll allow you to look at it and they take it into the research room.
So it has to defrost.
Basically, yes. Yeah. A defrost for refrigerator, if you can, you know, buy that and use that. But yeah, it's defrosting, and you need to let that warm up before you use it.
And if some of the people listening do have some of this film, how would you suggest after copying it? Is there a proper way to deal with that material after they've made their copies, made their reproduction?
A couple ways I could answer that question. If their film is really deteriorating, you know, with the nitrate film, you can tell that it becomes mushy. It sticks to any other medium that it's stored with. It literally becomes like soup eventually. You can't do anything with that. So if you pull a copy, but then you call the fire department. You don't get rid of it. We don't take it out behind the building and throw it into the dumpster. That's too dangerous. So we've done in the past call the Tallahassee Fire Department, and they know what to do with it.
We have another question. Sometimes I get just flummoxed by the answers because we call the fire department.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah.
I want to get ready. Can we?
A lot of these processes are not safe to handle.
Wow. I learn every time we do these sessions. Sarah had some questions about storage, and so storing, and you talked about this a bit, so storing in acid-free paper, not in plastic.
Depends on the process. You could go there again. I think if you're dealing with polyester film, that's in good condition. I prefer to put it in a safe polyester enclosure. That way, you look at the image without taking it in and out of the sleeve, which can sometimes cause it to get scratched or handled too much. There are certain things you don't want to put. You don't want to put an albumin print, for example, in a clear plastic sleeve. I wouldn't recommend that. So if she has a list of processes, you know, I can go through that list and tell her specifically, because there are specific recommendations with each process.
Okay. We'll provide Jody's contact information. Jody's going to be busy.
Yeah. I'm happy to do it.
Jody's going to be busy. And then you talk about storing things in the freezer, so that as an option.
Something. You know, for the majority of the photographic processes in the state archives, we store them at 38 degrees and 50% relative humidity. It's not ideal, but it is cost affordable, and it does slow down the degradation and frequently stops the degradation.
And now I know it's so cold.
It's very cold.
It's very cold.
Yeah, a question about nitrocellulose. Was it ever used for movie film?
Not only used, it was preferred. And in fact, well, let me back up a little bit. It was used absolutely, and it blew up a Chicago City block as a result one day. Very unsafe. Containers, enclosed containers, don't allow the gases from nitrate to escape. So it's a dangerous situation to do that. But yes, in the beginning, that's what was only used.
Would it have been used in the home movie film in the early 1950s, late 40s?
I'm going to say no. Possible, but I don't think so.
Okay. Just as soon as you got some really deteriorated home movies, if you said that's getting kind of mushy soupy, and I'm just thinking we need to get rid of that stuff.
It sounds like you need to get rid of it, but let's talk a little bit about cellulose acetate film before you make that determination whether it's nitrate or cellulose acetate.
Okay.
So acetate film was introduced in 1830 by Eastman Kodak.
1930,
I'm sorry.
That's okay. Just
want to
make sure.
One of the ways that you can determine if it's safety or if it's nitrate, safety film always has safety embossed along the edges. And like I said before, nitrate, really early nitrate, has nothing along the edges. And later on, they start embossing on the side of the film, nitrate film. So if you can look at that and make that determination, well, that's a place to start. So we talk a little bit about the unsafety safe film. It turned out not to be safety at all. And like nitrate, had really serious conditions. Over a period of time, the film base shrinks. Causes the emulsion to buckle, the deterioration can be greatly accelerated by poor storage conditions. And one of the first obvious signs of deterioration is a vinegar-like smell, and the second is the buckling or warping of the negative. Finally, if you find one that's been not taken care of for a while, the emulsion will completely separate from the base of the film. At that point, there's not much you can do. You can't make a contact print. You might as well just destroy it. When talking about nitrate versus acetate film, cellulose acetate was very popular when movie film was introduced because of it. Yeah, it works very well with movie film. I'm not certain, I can't say for sure, but I don't think nitrate was as popular with a movie film as cellulose acetate. But they were both used. Even about film being in a very deteriorating state, so let's talk about those deteriorating states. With cellulose acetate, you've got the vinegar smell right off the bat. That's one of the jobs I had when I first started here. I would open file cabinets and just sniff drawer after drawer after drawer. Once I determined that something might smell like vinegar, then I went in with my hands and tried to figure out which ones were reticulating. I haven't had as much exposure, but I've dealt with thousands of nitrate films. Your description about how it turns to mush and everything sticks to it, and in fact, the slide we showed with the J.K. Small notes sticking to it, give you an idea. It's like glue. So it very well could be nitrate film. If that's the case, you're kind of in a bind. The only thing I know to do there to send it off would be to someone like Northeast Document Center. They do a lot of work. They do a lot of chemical correction, and they'd be able to save those films for you. If it's a tape film, again, it depends on the stage of the deterioration. We might be able to help you with that. So I hope that was of some help in identifying what you have and what it is. It would be easier, and this is one case that a webinar doesn't really lend itself to, hang on with photographic processes. It would be easier for me to see it and smell it to know what kind of film it is and what we might be able to do with it. It can reticulate or deteriorate to a severe degree before it's not transferable or not printable.
So someone contact you and schedule an appointment to come and actually bring their document, their materials to you, and you take a look at them.
Absolutely, yeah, that's what I'm here for. I'm happy to do that. Okay. Next. These are examples using safety film. can see that there's been no reticulation yet. We do periodic checks, like I told you, so we'll go through our big film collections, which are mostly newspaper collections, and walk up and down the file cabinet smelling and pulling out and printing and destroying them. But saved thousands and thousands of images. One thing is, Jim Riley, who is the lead guy on acetate film and the period of deterioration that we're bound to see, is he says it's going to deteriorate. Doesn't matter where you get it stored or what you're doing, it's going to deteriorate. So start doing now to copy it and reproduce it. Okay. We moved to polyester film. That was in 1955, and we still use polyester film today. It was introduced by East Modec as a safe replacement for nitrate film. And in fact, the word safety is printed along the border of the film. Well, unfortunately, okay, we're going back to polyester, right? Okay, polyester film. So it was introduced as a safety alternative, and in fact it has been. It's still used today with the exception of some cinema films, which I think someone asked about. Movie films are really hard to splice. Movie theaters still like using safety film. I think what they typically do is produce the master on safety film and then reproduce it onto a stable polyester base. Polyester is inherently more chemically stable than any other cellulose nitrate or cellulose acetate. And one way to identify polyester film is to try and tear it. I wouldn't recommend that with your best images. Maybe focus on a corner or something. But polyester film tears very difficultly, whereas acetate and nitrate will tear very quickly, just like that. So just a quick recap on those three photo processes. Older films will often say nitrate or safety along the edges of the film. Polyester film will have a batch number or date along the edge of the film. Kodak film was produced after 1951 is nitrate, and no film of any kind is polyester before 1955. Lime through the side of a roll of film will shine through if it's polyester, but will not if it's acetate. Polyester film is strong, hard to tear, unlike acetate. And if the film has vinegar-like smell, it's safety film, and it's in the beginning stages of reticulation or degradation. For color processes, color, of course, encompasses a number of processes. In 1935, Kodak introduced Kodachrome. That same year, Agfacolor introduced Agfacolor. Kodak was available only in 16mm film for home movies, but in 1936 it was also introduced as an 8mm home movie and short lengths of 35 film for photography. In 1938, sheet film in various sizes, color sheet film in various sizes for professional photographers was introduced. In 1941, color print paper was available commercially. And in 1963, Polaroid introduced the first instant color film. And now we have digital, different than anything we've talked about today. Digital is the first process where the image can be displayed, printed, stored, manipulated, transmitted, archived, using digital and computer techniques. There's no chemical processing. So the image is focused on the camera chip inside the camera, instantly converted to an image, and you can see the screen on the back of your camera, through the viewfinder or on the back of your camera. capture image is digitized and stored as a computer file ready for digital processing, viewing, or printing. There's a long, long, long list of wonderful attributes that can be applied to digital photography. I was the last told of, I think. Digital cameras are a green technology. They don't use film, no photo processing. It saves on silver and a lot of other nasty chemicals that don't have to be disposed of or dumped in the environment. Digital cameras allow you to see the photo instantly, so you don't have to guess or wonder how the picture came out. Digital images can be used almost always instantly. They can be sent via email, dropped in a brochure, PowerPoints, posted on social media, etc. The print loss is reduced. In my case, it's eliminated. Cheap, faster, traditional photography. Cheap, faster than traditional photography. And if you buy the software package, Photoshop, you basically have your own built-in darkroom. And a really nice darkroom. Now, there are many commercial photographers, myself included, and some amateur photographers who still have been resistant to using digital photography rather than film photography. And that's because we believe that the image quality available from a digital camera is still inferior to that from your traditional film camera. I will say that's changing every day. That's the journey from daguerreotype to digital. I hope that you've been able to use some of the information I've provided. I went through it fairly quickly. I believe, if you have any questions, please, please do not hesitate to email with questions.
And so we've got to answer some questions. If you've got some last questions, we get a question from Quinn, who is, and I'm going to go back because I want to get it right. Quinn, because I found this fascinating. Quinn is actually a daguerreotypist and works in wet collodion. So fascinating. But Quinn's question about aristotypes, and so I'm thinking we want to take that offline because that's not something one of the processes.
Well, I could stumble over it, but I'd rather do some research and get back to him. Yeah.
So we're gonna have Jody get back to you when we're offline. She'll contact you and you guys can chat about that question. Want to check and see if we've got other questions, and as we do that, Melissa's gonna put up some other things, and John will talk about the Florida memory thing.
Sure. Thanks, Stephanie. What you're seeing now is the front page to the Florida Memory website. If you go to it today, it's going to look a little bit different than what you're seeing here. Many of the photos that Jody talked about are available through the Florida Memory website. You'll see there in the upper left corner below the Florida Memory icon is the photographic section. If you click on that, that'll take you to the Florida Photographic Collection online, which can be searched in a variety of ways. You'll see that we also have video, audio, collections, which are scans of archival documents from collections housed in the State Library and Archives of Florida. We also have exhibits and an online classroom, which incorporates the materials on Florida Memory into the Sunshine State Standards, and as we speak, the new ones we're putting up with the Common Core Standards. I'd like to also mention that you can also, in addition to getting in touch with Jody about some of the things that we discussed today, we do have some items we can send you in the mail. For example, we have some new brochures recently printed, Florida Memory brochures. On the back of these, you'll find a QR code, which will take you to the website. If you're a library or another cultural institution in Florida and you'd like some brochures to put in packs and hand out to your visitors, we'd be happy to send those to you. You can see here, we'd like you to email us at archives@us.myflorida.com. We'd like to know, of course, your name. If you're from a library or cultural institution, please include that. Mailing address and phone number, how many brochures you'd like. And we'd also like to know how you'd use them. I'd like to mention about Florida Memory. We are out there on social media quite a bit. What you're seeing now is what you'll see on the Florida Memory webpage and what we've called Connect to Us. We have a blog. We post a few posts a week, so please check out our blog. You can see the latest blog post on the front page of Florida Memory. We also have a Facebook site that's tied to the State Archives of Florida. We do Twitter, Flickr, YouTube, Pinterest, Tumblr, and we also have an RSS feed that you can follow to get the latest additions to the Florida Photographic Collection and also the audio that's put up on the Florida Memory website by our wonderful sound archivist, Will Chase. Please follow us. Engage with us on our social media. We find that a lot of people, libraries in particular, like to use our photographs on their own Facebook pages. We have really good friends down in Alachua County that frequently put up photos and say, well, where is this? And get their patrons and people who visit their website and engage in their Facebook to find out where those photos are. So there's a ton of material on Florida Memory, over 175,000 photographs, new ones being added each week. So check back frequently, become a frequent visitor to Florida Memory. Finally, upcoming webinar. As many are aware, this year marks the 500-year anniversary of the arrival of Europeans and Africans in what we now call Florida. Trina Harkness and I are going to be conducting a webinar on Thursday, March 14th, on how to use the Florida Memory website to enhance your Viva Florida events and programming. We'll talk a little bit about what Viva Florida is, can find on Florida Memory, and how to take advantage of what we've made available to you online when you are planning your events over the coming year.
Thank you, John. John's great at that. I can do that, but I stumble over it. Lives and breathes it. So we have, I pushed out a bunch of links as John was speaking, and we set up registration for the next webinar in March, and if you've got other questions, you can send them to archives@dos.myflorida.com. We've also pushed out Jody's direct email, so for those of you who want to contact her with specific questions, and I do want to say we will get Jody to connect with you to answer your specific questions. But we have just a couple more minutes. If you've got additional questions, if you want to put them into chat or raise your hand or ask them using the Q&A button, Q&A panel, that would be great. I want to, as we wait for additional questions, thank Jody and John and Katrina for all the work that went into putting this presentation together. Especially, this was I found it fascinating. The questions, I think we had people enjoy the program as well. So we'll look to see if we have a few more questions. Remind you that we did record out a link to the recording, and we encourage you to share that and make that available as well. And Sarah is asking, how can a local collection link up with the Florida Memory page? And connect to it, you can just make a link to it, but John, do you want to?
Well, we do have on our front page, you can download the Florida Memory icon if you'd like to put the icon onto your web page and then link to Florida Memory.
Do you have any other information about that, Katrina? Nope.
I should also, occasionally when we put together resources for things like History Fair and on our online classroom, for example, last year, Katrina built a page for History Fair, and a lot of the topics tend to be of local interest. Or I should say that judges, History Fair, like myself and Katrina included, we like to see local topics. So if you have archival collections at your library or museum, and as we develop our History Fair pages, for example, going forward, we do include links to archival collections. So not print collections that have items that are available in a lot of different places, but if you have unique materials you'd like us to link to, in the case of developing something like our History Fair pages, we can certainly do that. I think, I hope that answers the question.
And to answer your question, if you want to do *6 to unmute your phone, and then you could just talk to us. *6 will unmute your phone if you want to clarify if we didn't get the gist of your question. We email them at archives. Okay, I didn't talk out loud, but that answered it. Okay, great. Thank you. Other questions from anyone? Push out the link. John mentioned you could download the icon so that when you link to memory, you could use that image they have. I pushed out the link to that, as well as the history fair information, 2012-2013, but you're updating that now.
The history fair contest is going on right now.
Go
students
ahead.
Are probably finishing their projects.
That's
and
the year we're in.
Yeah, we're in 2013. And the students will be working. This is the time where they're almost really finalizing. So to look at the topics as they come out next year, that'll be it over the summer.
Mm-hmm.
So in late summer next year.
Around August, probably.
Katrina is saying around August. And that's when she puts together her fabulous history fair page.
Thank you for joining us. Thank Jody very much for the content. Jody did the heavy lifting today. And we look forward to seeing you back here in March for the next installment. We talk about the Viva Florida Memory to enhance your Viva Florida programming. So thank you and have a great day.